Okay, good morning, everyone. Can I welcome you to the 23rd meeting in 2014 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee? Can I remind everybody to switch off their mobile phones, as they do affect the broadcasting system? Agenda item one is items in private. Can I seek the agreement of the committee to take items 5 and 6 in private? Item 5 is to allow the committee to consider proposals for future inquiries, and item 6 will be to consider the evidence heard on homelessness in Scotland. Are members agreed? Agreed? That is agreed, thank you. Agenda item 2 is homelessness in Scotland. The second item of business today is to hear evidence from the Minister for Housing and Welfare on homelessness in Scotland as part of the committee's inquiry. So today, can I welcome Margaret Burgess, Minister for Housing and Welfare, and Marion Gibbs, Team Leader Homelessness from the Scottish Government. Can I welcome you both? And Minister, would you like to make an opening statement?
Thank you for being. It's almost 2 years since the 2012 homelessness commitment, which is widely recognised as being the most progressive homelessness legislation in Europe. We have seen a culture change in the way homelessness services are delivered in Scotland since then, and the development of housing options by local authorities has seen homelessness services focus on the individual or family and on securing the best most sustainable housing outcome. Local authorities have attributed this to the continued falls in homelessness in recent years, and importantly to better outcomes for homeless people. The Scottish Government established the establishment of 5 local authority-led hubs, which has seen local authorities and their partners working together to develop and implement homelessness prevention approaches. The Scottish Government continues to support and facilitate the work of the Housing Options Hubs. We are providing £150,000 of ongoing support funding for 2014-15 to assist the hubs to continue to develop strategies around homelessness prevention, including welfare reform mitigation. We are also committed to continual improvement in the provision of housing options. We are working with our local authority partners and others to develop housing options guidance for local authorities, as was recommended by the recent Scottish Housing Regulators report. Housing support can have a crucial impact on addressing homelessness and sustaining tenancies, particularly amongst vulnerable groups. And last week we saw the publication of newly revised housing support guidance to assist local authorities in implementing the housing support duty to homeless households, introduced in 2013. More broadly, the first year of implementation of the duty doesn't indicate any significant impact on the delivery of local authority services. And this is because most were already engaged in the provision of support for homeless households. However, the guidance has developed joint working at a corporate level in local authorities and between local authorities and their partners who deliver housing support. As well as preventing homelessness, wherever possible, the Scottish Government is committed to delivering at least 30,000 affordable homes during the life of this Parliament, with 20,000 of these being houses for social rent. And I'm pleased that two-thirds of the way into our 5-year target, we have delivered 21,322 affordable homes, 15,088 of these for social rent, which is 75% of our social rent target. The Scottish Government recognises the progress we've made in addressing homelessness in Scotland is against a backdrop of difficult economic times and welfare reforms, which pose a significant threat to future progress. We are committed to working with partners to impact on these when we can. But I am clear that early intervention is key to reducing homelessness, and the Scottish Government will continue to work closely with local authorities and their partners to prevent homelessness before it occurs. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Perhaps can I start off by asking how you think the abolition of priority need and the rollout of the housing options approach has impacted on homelessness services across Scotland?
Okay, well, as I said in my opening remarks, convener, I think that the abolition of priority need means that we do have the most progressive homelessness legislation in Europe. It allows all unintentionally homeless people to settle to accommodation. And I think that is a very effective legal safety net for people facing homelessness. But I do think equally as important is the approach we're taking to preventing homelessness in the first instance. I think that approach is key to the fall in figures that we're seeing just now in people both presenting as homelessness and being assessed as homelessness. So I do think the housing options approach has had an impact. It also is beneficial in terms of the work that's been done across local authorities and working with partners. There is a very joined up approach now to delivering support for homeless households, and I think that that practice is still, I mean, we've not completed, it's not perfect yet, but it is being shared out across Scotland, and the hubs ensure that best practice can be shared and delivered in other areas. So I do think that abolishing the priority need has had a significant impact.
Mentioned that we can look at best practice, but nothing ever stays the same, and the conditions of people presenting as homeless or the number of people on the homelessness list always moves. So 2 years on, what is the government doing to review the effectiveness of the 2012 commitment?
Well, we continually, before that we reached the commitment, the government had the 2012 steering group, which was a group of very key partners and players in terms of delivering homeless support and strategy. And that group, we kept on that group as the Homeless Prevention and Strategy Group. And that group has a kind of strategic overview of homelessness in Scotland and meets quarterly. I attend it twice a year. We review, obviously, not just the statistics that are coming forward under our current way of recording statistics, but have developed a way of recording the Prevent One, which is a new statistical recording from April, which will look at how we can best get both the outcomes and the support that are provided to homeless households and look at how, if the preventative approach is delivering the way we think it's delivering. So, as you say, Convener, it is dynamic. Things change all the time. We're open to external issues like welfare reform. There's other issues coming up in welfare reform which will undoubtedly impact in homeless households in Scotland. And the Homeless Prevention and Strategy Group continually is looking at that, overseeing that. The hubs discuss it regularly. The information is fed out to the regional hubs, and each local authority in their housing options team are look at these issues as well. It's fed back and looked at strategically, and I think that is the way that we'll have to continue to do it. It is not finished, and that was recognised when we continued with the group that had that expertise, and that group has all the key players: Alacho, Solus, COSLA, Scottish Government, Shelter, Homeless Action Scotland are involved in it now. So it is a group that works well together with a common aim.
And how confident are you that the government and yourself have a good understanding of the levels of homelessness in Scotland, given that the Scottish Housing Regulator's findings, which said that the current local authority practice may have resulted in the under-reporting of homelessness?
I mean, we certainly are aware of the regulator's comments on that, and something that we are looking at and the group is looking at. But I think with the current statistics that we have, which I can't remember what they're called, HL1, and our Prevent, the new statistical recording, will give us a very good overview of what is happening in homelessness and also in housing support in Scotland, because the Prevent One will record the kind of support provided and the outcomes of it. So I do think that we have taken on board what the regulator has said. The Homelessness Prevention and Strategy Group is looking at that, and it's very the new statistical recording, and I think that the regulator commented on that as well, will give us a very good picture of homelessness across Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Alex, do you want to continue?
It was just in relation to what you were talking about there. I wonder if there was anything else you could tell us to update us on the work of the Scottish Government is undertaken to introduce mandatory data collection. How advanced is that process?
Well, the HL1, as I understand it, is mandatory data collection.
Yeah.
The first the statistics we currently record, and the Prevent one is still being, well, it's rolled out on the 1st of April, and that will be recorded by every local authority in Scotland, and that will also be mandatory, as I understand it. So that is mandatory and has been agreed by the group and by local authorities in COSLA that will be mandatory.
Once you've got that information, how do you intend to use it? For instance, you mentioned there about the housing regulation regulator recommendations, but for example, the success of housing options, for example, is that something you feel you'll be able to get a better understanding of?
Absolutely. It will have a better understanding of the outcomes, whether or not a homeless application was made, whether or not the family or the individual were housed through without going down the homeless route or did go down the homeless route, what support was provided to them, and that will be all captured in Prevent One. And I think we'll get a much clearer picture of what is happening in homelessness and housing in Scotland.
Are you able at this stage to give me any indication of the timescales that will be involved in the loop there? By that I mean quite often we get figures, but these figures can be a month or 3 months or 6 months or a year out of date. How quickly will the feedback loop work, and how quickly will you be able to act on information received?
That information I can't give you at this moment, but we can certainly look at that and get back to you with that information.
Thank you. The committee, moving on to specifically to housing options, the committee has heard evidence to suggest that housing options has not always improved housing outcomes for young people. How can the Scottish Government help to facilitate good outcomes for young homeless people?
I mean, I certainly also think that the committee heard evidence that young people were better served with housing options as well. And my view is that young people should be served better by the housing options approach, because they are looking at the individual, they're looking at, in terms of housing options, the range of options available to that young person. It's not just about handing someone a set of keys and saying, yes, okay, you're homeless. It's looking about the circumstances of why they are presenting as homeless or presenting as looking for accommodation. There can be, I mean, I've visited a number of projects and spoken to a number of young people who've come through the homeless route or had started in the homeless route, and I can give examples, for example, of one young girl who got space away from her family. The family relationship had broken down with her father, a bit of space in temporary accommodation for a short period of time, moving back into the family home, and she was very anxious and keen to move back into the family home, and had moved back into the family home, was going to college, but planning in the future to get a flat with the support of her family. So, and she recognised herself that she would not have been able to sustain a tenancy on her own. So I think the housing options gives that kind of support in saying, well, okay, maybe a bit of space is required. There's other examples, for example, when they might look at what someone needs, perhaps not ready to go into accommodation of their own, perhaps not able to go back to their own family home, but looking at shared accommodation, shared tenancies, matching people with someone, that giving it I don't want to use the word a shot, but an opportunity to meet a suitable young person that they could share a tenancy with, where for not every young person being in their own is the right option, and all of that can come out through a good housing options interview, that young people should be able to have a range of options and get the one that's most suitable to them, and it's not always just going down the homeless route.
Mm-hmm. I agree with the Minister, we have heard some very strong positives when we've talked to people about this, but we've also heard some concerns expressed, and one specifically was the housing options route in relation to care leavers, for example. Is there anything specific you have to say about that?
Well, I mean, my view is that the housing options route should be good for care leavers in terms of a planned programme. I don't think care leavers should be going through the homeless route, but they should be going through housing options in a planned way prior to being taken up, whatever form of tenancy they take up. I would certainly think, we also, I think, published guidance, but we did publish guidance in line with the Children and Young Persons Act on housing protocols for care leavers to ensure that those supporting those leaving care are getting appropriate housing support. And I think one of the areas for the hubs is that's something when there is good practice, where it's falling down, we need to improve it. I mean, absolutely, if it's not happening, it should be happening, and we need to improve it. And I think that's one way that the hubs can work together, look at where is good practice, why is it not working somewhere else, and if you know, and try and get that, address that and get it right. But care leavers should get, in my view, through the housing options approach, not down necessarily the homeless route, should get a good service, a planned service, so that they get the accommodation that's right and suitable for them.
Thank you.
Okay, and Jim.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Minister.
Morning.
Can I ask you about welfare? I've received a range of evidence from witnesses on the impact of welfare reform on housing options. We've heard that the bedroom tax has meant that more homeless people want to wait for accommodation or an offer of accommodation that is appropriate for their household size. We've heard that the shared accommodation rated for housing benefit claimants in the private rented sector has been extended from those aged 25 and under to those aged 35 and under. And we heard last week about the high cost of temporary accommodation and changes to the way it will be funded under universal credit, with concern being raised about the affordability of temporary accommodation in the future. Can I ask you, therefore, what the Scottish Government has been able to do and will continue to do to help local authorities and registered social landlords mitigate the impact of welfare reform on their housing options and homelessness prevention work? And can I ask you if welfare reform has meant that the meeting the 2012 target has become more challenging?
I think there's no doubt about it that welfare reform has a huge impact on housing and in homelessness in Scotland, and has in some way made it more challenging to meet the targets that we want to meet and to take housing forward the way that we want to take housing forward. Certainly in terms of the housing and homelessness strategy group, that welfare reform has been a standing item on the agenda. It's also a standing item on the agenda at every regional hub meeting, and looking at what is available and what can be done and how that can be shared. Now, the Scottish Government has done what we can to mitigate welfare reform in terms of the bedroom tax, in ensuring that nobody should suffer because of the bedroom tax, and have fully mitigated it in this financial year. We've also given considerable resources to Scottish Legal Aid Board and the Making Advice Work Project to Citizens Advice Scotland, and also funding that can be accessed by housing association and local authorities to give people the best advice to ensure that their income is maximised, and that early on there's identified if there's an issue in terms of rent. There is more coming. We can't pretend that we've heard recently from the Westminster, from the Tory government in Westminster, that there is not give housing benefit to 18 and to 21-year-olds, and we cannot pretend that that's not going to be a significant problem here in Scotland. And I may say a bit more about that later. In terms of the temporary accommodation, absolutely there is a real issue with temporary accommodation and the funding of temporary accommodation. The bulk of temporary accommodation in Scotland is provided by local authorities and RSLs, and we are very anxious that temporary accommodation is the best quality possible. We're very much aware that temporary accommodation, it costs more. The maintenance of temporary accommodation costs more because of the turnover. And the Homeless and Prevention Strategy Group did a major piece of work on the costs of reasonable temporary accommodation. And that was looking about, you know, quality accommodation, good quality accommodation, but also has to take into account like how often furniture would need to be changed, because temporary accommodation is furnished, about how often white goods would need to be replaced, about the high cost of maintenance, voids, any periods of voids, what the cost of that would be, and then looking at what can be, what's available through universal credit and the difference in the cost. And we jointly, with COSLA, wrote to the UK government on this matter to say, look, there's a real issue here, because, you know, people need to have temporary accommodation. This costs, and, you know, there is a shortfall here, and it's partly of your making. So we've done that. We've also looked at a number of other areas. We have looked at the standard, as you'll be aware, on temporary accommodation to ensure that it is unsuitable accommodation. Any accommodation that's not wind and water type will be unsuitable, and we've clarified that after the Housing Act from representations by yourself to do that. So we're doing what we can as a government, but we recognise there are still challenges to come for local authorities and for the Scottish Government through welfare reform. The Homeless Prevention and Strategy Group are well aware of this as an important item on the agenda every occasion. But, I mean, at this moment, we can't say we can mitigate everything that is coming in from Westminster. We'll have to wait and see what happens, perhaps, with the Smith Commission, if there will be any leeway or ability for us to do more.
Convener, can I just put on record my appreciation to the Minister for her action and leadership in responding to the concerns that were raised by myself on behalf of Shelter Scotland in relation to making temporary accommodation wind and watertight, and the further legislation that is coming forward to address that. But can I ask you about the mitigation of the bedroom tax? Clearly, the Scottish Government, with the support of parties in Parliament at the time of the budget, were able to commit funding to fully mitigate the impact of the bedroom tax, but that was only because we had managed to persuade the UK Government to raise the cap on discretionary housing payments. Can I just ask you whether the Scottish Government will be in a position to fully fund the mitigation of the impact of the bedroom tax in the financial year 2015-16?
Well, as you'll be aware, and as the committee will be aware, that the budget announcement will be tomorrow, and therefore, you know, that's when any statements will be made in the budget. But generally, in terms of the bedroom tax, the DWP, it's been based on the allocations from the DWP to each local authority area, and that is when the Scottish Government's allocate to local authorities or work out their allocation, and we don't normally get that information till later in the year or the beginning of the next financial year. But at this moment, the budget is tomorrow, not today, and I can't answer that further at the moment.
Okay. You mentioned the situation facing 18 to 21-year-olds, given proposals that are coming from other parties who may be in government after the next election or not, as the case may be. Has the Scottish Government undertaken any kind of assessment of what the impact of the removal of housing benefit for 18 to 21-year-olds would be in terms of homelessness? Because, you know, I'm one of those who's old enough to remember that a previous UK government removed the entitlement of 16 and 17-year-olds to social security benefits, and that actually led to 16 and 17-year-olds literally being on the street as rough sleepers. So have you undertaken an impact assessment of what the likely consequences of removing housing benefit for 18 to 21-year-olds would be?
We've looked at, I think we should say that it's been quite sketchy what we've been information we have from the UK government about who's going to be impacted by it, because that they have indicated there will be some exceptions. Care leavers will be an exception, single parents and some vulnerable people, which, you know, we don't quite know what that means. So it's not as clear, but it could cost up to 12,500 people in Scotland, an average of £360 a month, and it could affect children in Scotland. And also, I think, crucially, it could affect young people who are working and in receipt of some sort of form of housing benefit. Again, they would be unable to sustain that tenancy without the housing benefit support they get. So we are currently looking at that, and because this was a very recent announcement, and doing some modelling on it and what the impact will be. There could be impact on care leavers who, well, they're not, their care leavers will be exempted. We hope all care leavers will be exempted. So there's a lot of imponderables there just now, but we certainly are looking about the impact it will have on people, the impact it will have in homelessness, and particularly and also young people who are in work and who are receiving some housing benefit to sustain a tenancy. They might not work where they originally lived. They may have moved somewhere and they're receiving housing benefit. And if that's stopped and they're not in a high income bracket, then it's actually adding to what we already see is in-work poverty is becoming more and more of a problem. So yes, we are looking at that and we're aware of that.
Okay, and just finally, Convener, one of the other issues that's been highlighted in the course of our inquiry by some of the smaller housing associations is their ability to find the resources required to undertake the housing options approach, and the concern has been expressed that the additional resources that are required to do this aren't as easy for smaller housing associations to access as some of the other registered social landlords. Are you aware of that problem?
I'm aware that that was raised as a problem to the committee, but I do think, you know, at this stage that many housing associations, including small housing associations, are very much involved in the preventative approach. Many of them run projects funded in some instances by the Scottish Government. For example, People and Communities Fund, they run employability projects, they have money advice teams, they have welfare officers, and all of those, it may not be recorded preventative work, but it's part of the preventative work that's going on. They are keeping and sustaining people in a tenancy, and prevention will be cheaper in the long run for them. So they may not see it as that. I mean, I would like to look at that a bit more, about where they feel that they're not able to participate in the preventative work, because certainly all the housing associations I've visited, and I've visited many, and many of the small ones, and they are very much ingrained in their communities. They're very much involved in what's going on in the community. They're running projects, and all of these projects are contributing to the preventative agenda. They are actually sustaining people in tenancies.
So are you saying that the housing options work is cost neutral, that there's no...
No, I'm not saying it's always
financial cost, resource implications.
I'm not always saying it's cost neutral, but those that are doing it may not see that as being part of the housing options and the homelessness in homelessness prevention, but the work they're doing in ensuring that people are getting assistance with their rent, if they're struggling with their rent, if they have issues, that many many housing associations changed the responsibilities of what housing officers do. It's very much more people-focused, and all of that's part of the preventative and housing options approach, and it's ensuring that people are maintaining their tenancies. So I appreciate that. I would like to see more about where they feel that the costs are involved in this, but I certainly think that we maybe don't recognise enough just what housing associations are doing in the homelessness agenda.
So your door is open as far as any concerns?
Absolutely. The door is always open for concerns, and we will hear about that when we produce our guidance, because we'll be consulting with housing associations as well and the guidance.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, Mark, do you want to continue this theme of guidance?
On that point of guidance, the Housing Regulators report did flag up that not all people who were involved with housing options were then offered a homeless assessment when it would have been appropriate to do so under the legislation. They made recommendations on the publication of guidance, and I know that your department has been drafting that guidance, just to ask to make sure that the approach is consistent across the country when that guidance will be published.
Okay. Well, the guidance is not my department, my officials that are producing the guidance, but we're involved in the guidance. The guidance has been produced now, if I'm right in saying, with Alacho and Cosla, and six local authorities in Scotland are prepared the first draft guidance, and they started that in June. There's subsequently been another two meetings since then, and the draft guidance was produced in September. That's then being looked at, and I think redrafted, and it will then go out for consultation, because it's important, and I think, as I mentioned earlier to the last question, that we involve everybody in the final guidance, so it will go out for consultation, and that will include service users, housing associations, RSLs, to get their views on the guidance as well, that makes sure that the guidance is as doing what we want it to do, and that everyone is aware of it and it can be consistently applied across Scotland. So that's how we intend to proceed with the guidance.
Do you have a timescale for the completion of that?
I will defer to Marion for that. We have at this moment.
We're working on the second draft currently, and we'll be having a meeting towards the end of October on that. Then we'll go out to the consultation, as the Minister has just referenced. What we thought was quite important, that we didn't move to a finalised document before we actually got the committee's report on homelessness as well, so we could reflect on any recommendations that you make in the actual guidance itself. So that's sort of like skews the timescale a little bit, but we thought that was an important part of the full process to make sure that your recommendations were incorporated within the guidance.
Okay. And once the guidance is complete and issued to authorities and RSLs, just ask how you would monitor the implementation of that guidance, just to ensure that consistency of approach, and also to ask whether, if you're making sure that the guidance is taken into account, the wider health and social care integration agenda.
Certainly, it would require to take into account the wider health and social care agenda, and I think that the parties involved in producing the guidance are also involved in the coordinating group for the health and social care agenda, so they could pull that together. And also any other guidance that we've talked about, for example, the guidance we have for care leavers, all of that, the guidance has to be consistent across the board, and that takes time to ensure we do that, but we want to be absolutely sure that it's consistent with any other guidance that is published. So we will be doing that. The Homeless Prevention and Strategy Group will have the overall kind of strategic role of looking at the guidance, feeding back how it's working and operating to ourselves and, if necessary, to the committee. I always anticipate that when we publish guidance, that other agencies will inform us if they feel it's not being adhered to as well, and I think that's important, that we get feedback of how the guidance is working, not just from those that are using it, but for those that are looking at it from further afield, perhaps some of the other organisations, the voluntary sector that are dealing with homeless groups as well. If they feel the guidance is not working, it's important that we know that, but it will be done, I think, through the housing, the Homelessness Prevention and Strategy Group, because they have the overall strategic view on homelessness in Scotland.
Thank you.
Okay, Mary?
Minister, I wanted to ask you a couple of questions about intentionally homeless decisions. Mm-hmm. And the latest statistical analysis of local authority intentionally homelessness shows that between April and June of this year, there were 391 intentionality decisions, which was a decrease on the previous recording of 479. But the statistics also indicate that 10 local authorities have higher rates of intentionality than might be expected. So what are the reasons for that, and what work has been done with those local authorities to lower that figure?
Mm-hmm. I mean, we're certainly looking at that, but I think it's important to say that overall it's a very small proportion of applications that are assessed as intentionally homeless, and that is reducing. And it is in particular areas that perhaps seeing an increase. And I think it was Aberdeenshire who said that they felt the increase was Aberdeenshire. Aberdeen said that they felt the increase was that people who were moving there with the anticipation of taking up work, but without looking at their housing situation before they got there, could be a reason. But I'm not complacent about this, and was certainly something that we would be looking at. But I would certainly want to be clear that whether someone is homeless, assessed as intentionally homeless or unintentionally homeless, they're still entitled to get the housing options approach and also get support and options that are available to them and be rehoused, whether it's into settled accommodation, whether it be temporary till some other plan is worked out for them. So it's not true to say that people are intentionally homeless, they get no support from the local authority or from Housing Options. It is simply that they get a different form of support, they get a different kind of advice and support, and I think that's appropriate. Nobody should be turned away. Local authorities still have obligations for children and young people. So they've got a number of obligations they've got to meet in any case, whether somebody's intentionally homeless or not intentionally homeless.
But specifically in the 10 areas where they have higher rates of intentionality, is any additional work being undertaken to reduce that figure?
Currently, to reduce the figure, we can certainly look at it. Reducing the figure suggests that the people that are being assessed as intentionally homeless shouldn't be assessed as intentionally homeless, and we need to have evidence to suggest that that's the case. There is no evidence that people, or I haven't had any evidence, that people are being assessed as intentionally homeless when they're not intentionally homeless. So therefore, we can certainly, we're looking and monitoring it closely just about. But overall, we've got to be clear that the assessments in intentional homeless are falling, and we would hope that would continue to do so, and we will certainly look at it. But I have had no evidence presented to me that people are being assessed as intentional homeless when they're not. Mm.
And the outcomes, the housing outcomes for applicants, particularly in those 10 areas, is there any difference in their outcomes as opposed to other local authority areas across the country? Mm-hmm.
In terms of how they address attention,
yes, how they address it and the outcome of being given or offered settled accommodation.
The indications are that people in these areas are still offered the housing options and are given options, temporary accommodation, sometimes a short Scottish secure tenancy, or other options available to them. And I think that the prevent. When the new tool will be able to capture that much better, we'll be able to capture across Scotland whether somebody, what the outcome of their application is or the advice they're given is. And I think that's one of the advantages of the Prevent One, that we'll be able to get that information much better.
Would you anticipate that the guidance that will be given to local authorities about intentionality, that might help reduce it?
The guidance in intentionality will remain much the same, but we can certainly look at, and the group will look at that, and I can certainly take it back to them as something that's been raised by the committee, that that perhaps that if you, there's a view there's some kind of inconsistency in the way local authorities determine intentionality, I'm certainly happy to look at that and feed that back. To be fed into to any guidance, it is quite consistent, and local authorities know clearly
that'd be very helpful.
How to assess it.
Yeah. And there are provisions in the Homelessness Scotland Act 2003 that would change local authorities' duties to assess for intentionality, to a power to assess for intentionality. And are you considering that there would be a benefit in commencing that provision, and what difference would that provision make?
I'm not sure if it would make any difference, because the power would certainly introduce a flexibility, so some local authorities could assess more people as intentionally homeless using that. I think it's important that we have the priority need test, and that is the safety net for people who are homeless or present as homeless. But I think also, as long as we're absolutely clear that if somebody isn't assessed as intentionally homeless, and they have a right to appeal to that, if they are assessed as intentionally homeless, that it's clear that there is support and advice offered to them. So I think we've got the two things. We've got the sort of safety net, which prevents any abuse whatsoever of the system, but also we have the support for people who are homeless for whatever reason. So I'm not sure changing the duty to a power would help that. I'm not persuaded that would help matters. I think it's about getting it right, and getting the consistency that you talked about earlier would be the best way forward.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Gordon?
Minister, you said earlier on about the problems associated with the funding of temporary accommodation. And certainly from evidence we heard last week, there was a suggestion by Alacho that it could be a shortfall as much as £25 million. We also heard that even if there's no money to pay for that temporary accommodation, there is still a duty to provide it. So, you know, what is the government doing to try and address that potential huge problem that's facing us?
I think the first thing is that we absolutely recognise there is a problem. It's an issue that I've raised with the Westminster government at every occasion that I've had a meeting with them. And as I said earlier, we cannot mitigate every single impact of welfare reform, but we are working very closely with the Homeless Prevention Strategy Group because they're aware of the issues as well. They're absolutely aware of the issues that there's going to be a shortfall and that we can't magic money out of air. So it is about looking at how we go forward, working with them to develop a solution. We haven't developed that solution yet of how we can meet this shortfall, but what we are doing is, A, we recognise that the shortfall is going to be there, and we're working with all key players in it to try and get a solution to this. It is something that, and it's one part of it, there are other things going to come. And as soon as we get a solution, we mitigated the bedroom tax. As soon as we get that, we've now got the temporary accommodation. We may come to some kind of arrangement for that, and then we have the 18 to 21-year-old housing benefit. And this is when we've constantly got, we are not in control or don't have the powers to deal with all of the aspects of it. And again, as I said earlier, at one point, the Smith Commission and how we look at that and what kind of powers we can get to this Parliament that can perhaps help in these ways. We need to ensure that what we do is going to assist people and not actually make the situation worse.
And trying to save costs, one of the witnesses last week highlighted that it's not unusual for people to spend a minimum of 6 months in temporary accommodation and even up to a year in temporary accommodation. Is the government doing anything to try and address that situation in order to reduce the amount of time that people are actually spending in temporary accommodation?
Well, what we're doing, as I said earlier, we have the target to increase the housing supply, and we're doing everything we can within the budget we have to increase the supply of housing and in social housing, which remains an absolute priority for this government. We're also looking at other ways of affordable housing that people can perhaps move from social housing into low-cost home ownership, access to other forms of housing, which releases another social house. We've introduced the right to buy, that we're stopping the right to buy to keep houses in the social rented sector. So we're doing what we can to increase the supply, because obviously increased supply of housing means that more houses available for those in temporary accommodation. We're looking at every way we can to reduce those lists and get people out of temporary accommodation.
I just want to move on to the other subject I was going to ask you about, which is housing options hubs. We're aware that there are 5 housing hubs within Scotland, and the housing regulator has pointed out that not all hubs are effective, and they're still in their early days, and everyone's still learning, and best practices needs to be shared. What support will the Scottish Government give to the development of the hubs in the future?
The Scottish Government continues to support the hubs, both financially and with official support. Attend all the meetings of the hubs. There's an annual event where all the hubs get together and we're sharing best practice, but it is early days, but it is absolutely important that it's incumbent on us as a government to ensure that when we see the best practice, then that is passed on to the other hubs, and we can follow how, if that's it's happening. But I mean, for me, the hubs are working well. They are working together. They're, as I said earlier, it's not perfect yet. We need to ensure where things are. Some are more advanced than others. Some were set up earlier than others. They are there's some great practice going on out there in the hubs. But yes, that has to be got through. Taken out to all the hubs, and we'll continue to do that with support, both financially and by using Scottish Government officials as well.
Okay, thanks very much.
Okay, and Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, you mentioned in your opening remarks that you'd issued revised housing support duty guidance. Yes. Just recently, last week even. Can't remember. Anyway.
Was fairly recently.
Fairly recently, yes. Could you tell us what the purpose of this was? Obviously, the original guidance wasn't very old at all. What was the reason for the revisions?
I think it was to review what we previously had, and also to put it on, you know, as it's a statutory obligation now, but to also ensure that the guidance is kind of split into policy and procedures, basically. And the policy background to take into account, I think was mentioned by a member earlier, the wider implications, you know, welfare reform, the integration of health and social secure, to make sure that it's always in context. The guidance itself in terms of the support offered hasn't changed a great deal. It will be reviewed again, and I think I said either in my opening remarks or in response to a question that there has been no significant change since the previous guidance, and we're not anticipating it from this guidance either, because as part of the preventative approach, most local authorities were providing that kind of housing support that we've now put onto a statutory footing. And I think it's important that we have it in a statutory footing, but it was recognised some time ago by local authorities and by their partners that really, as part of the preventative approach, as much support as possible that can be provided to people to either sustain a tenancy or keep them in a current tenancy is the way forward. So that just puts it on that kind of footing. But it's something, it's like any guidance, that will be reviewed constantly in light of how the feedback we get, because we're always it's about feedback from those that have received support and also from those that are using the support and through the hubs. And it will be changed again, no doubt, in 12 months' time. But I think that's important. The guidance doesn't just sit there forever, and we need to change it.
So how is it monitored then? What's the process?
It's again, that will come out also in the Prevent One in terms of the support that's provided to people. We'll be able to see that, but currently it's looked at. Some of it's gathered in the existing statistics, but not to the level we would want. But most of that support will come out in Prevent One. Did somebody get money advice? Was it a benefits issue? Did they need employability support? Were they referred to external agencies for addiction services or whatever? And it will give us a much clearer picture of the kind of support that's being provided, but more importantly, the actual outcomes after providing that support.
Okay. Thank you. Final question for the session is, how would you respond to Shelter's suggestion that the government needs to prepare an action plan for homelessness for the next 10 years?
I think, I don't see homelessness sitting in isolation to housing in general. It has to fit in with all of what's happening within housing, and we're constantly looking and reviewing at how we go forward with housing in terms of housing supply, homelessness, in terms of what's happening to benefits, what's happening in the private sector. So all of that homelessness has to sit in the whole housing system. And you may be aware we're holding a major housing event in November, and that major housing event, we've been working towards this for a considerable time with stakeholder groups to determine what are the issues that need to be looked at. And this is about how we take housing forward, certainly for the next 5 years. What are the issues, the challenges, how we address them. The event, we've already had discussions with over 70 stakeholders in preparing for the event, and we anticipate over 300 stakeholders to be present at the event. And I think homelessness will be very much at the core of that, because it is part of the whole housing system. And so, and Shelter will be involved in this event, as will every other stakeholder, and that's when we will be able to look at it. But it will, in my view, have to be part of it. It doesn't sit separate from housing. It has to be part of the whole housing system, and also, you know, in how we look at preventing it as well. It's all one. It's not just sitting in the side of it.
Okay. Well, we can look forward to the outcomes of that event. And
it will be in November. I think the 18th of November is the date we have for it.
Okay, thank you.
Minister might want to come back and report on that event. And also, yesterday we had an informal briefing from RICS on their recent report. And perhaps want to say what you think about that as well, but it might all tie in neatly later on in the year. Does anyone else have any further questions? Anything you wish to add, Minister?
I don't think so, other than just to inform you about the event, and clearly I know the committee will be interested in the outcome of that.
Yep. Okay, can I thank you both very much for your attendance and for your evidence today. That's been very helpful. Can I call a short suspension to allow the witnesses to leave the room? Can resume. Agenda item 3 is Deregulation Bill UK Parliament legislation. This is to consider a supplementary legislative consent memorandum on the Deregulation Bill. Amendments have been made to the bill to include a provision to enable the investigation of tramway accidents in Scotland by the Rail Accident Investigation Branch, and separately provisions which enable Scottish ministers to introduce a regime which would permit motorsports on public roads. Because the Deregulation Bill alters the executive competence of Scottish ministers, legislative consent is required. So paper 3 includes the LCM and provides details of the LCM procedure. The committee is invited to consider whether to report that the committee is content with the LCM and with the Scottish Government's view that it is in the best interests of the Scottish people and good governance that the relevant provisions of the bill should be considered by the UK Parliament, or defer consideration of the SLCM to a future meeting and take further evidence. Do members have any comments? No. So is the committee content for the relevant provisions in the bill to be considered by the UK Parliament? Yeah. Yep, that is agreed then. Thank you very much. Agenda item 4 is subordinate legislation. It is to the consideration of the negative instrument on homelessness persons unsuitable accommodation, Scotland Order 2014. Kind of follows on neatly from what the Minister was saying. This negative instrument relates to what constitutes suitable temporary accommodation for certain categories of homeless persons. committee will consider any issues that it wishes to raise in reporting to the Parliament on this instrument. Members should note that no motions to annul have been received in relation to these instruments. Does anyone have any comments to make?
Can I just comment that this is a very welcome development, and it's something that came about as a result of the committee and the Parliament's consideration of the most recent housing bill. It was an issue that I tabled an amendment on with support from Alec Rowley, MSP, and I'm delighted that the government has listened to the representations it received at that stage and has decided to bring forward this subordinate legislation, which in particular extends the existing legislation to include the provision that accommodation is unsuitable if it is not wind and watertight. And I think we need to remember that, you know, our role as members of the Scottish Parliament, as legislators, is to improve the lives of the people of Scotland, and I think this is a piece of legislation that will absolutely do that for vulnerable families and children who are affected by homelessness.
Yep. OK, is the committee agreed that it doesn't wish to make any recommendation in relation to this instrument?
Agreed.
That is agreed. OK, thank you. That concludes the committee's business in public today, and we will now move to private session, as previously agreed. I suspend briefly.